we have these words, education, examination, competition, syllabus, coaching, results, ranks, seats, universities, jobs, dollars. These are the words that are mostly used in our country. So overly used that they have actually undermined the importance of something called learning, a beautiful experience called learning. So this is where I want to pitch my talk. Is learning a rhetoric or a narrative? Is learning a rhetoric or a narrative? Because this word is just not a word. It's just not an action. It's an experience. Such a wonderful experience that unless you start looking at it as an experience and an engagement, you would not know the beauty of it. In the last 15 days, I don't know how many of you have seen this video on Facebook, doing rounds on internet, YouTube, WhatsApp, everywhere. A young man wanting to sue the school system. Why? Because the school wants to test a fish by its ability to climb a tree. Wonderful, he wants to sue the school system. Now, in the last one decade, there's another video, a talk by Sir Ken Robinson, an eminent educationist. Across the world, he's well known. His talk is more popular because the title of the talk is, Do Schools Kill Creativity? Okay? Just like somebody said, don't judge a book by its cover, don't judge his talk by its title. He's not saying that schools kill creativity, but he's asking, do schools kill creativity? And then we have a cartoon for the last two decades doing rounds across the world on the education system, not just in India, across the world. They're asking for a fair selection. Everybody has to take the same exam. So please climb that tree. Now, these three slides are actually talking about how bad the education system is. What a dinosaur system we have. Everybody's pointing fingers at it. Everybody's saying, criticizing things about education system. Everybody says schools are bad, colleges are bad, universities are bad. My point here is, schools, colleges, universities, they're a part of a system called education system, created by a political leadership in any country, not just in India, any country. Now, it is a system that has to take a change, not schools, colleges, universities, because if they have to be formal entities, they need to be a part of the system. They just can't break the norms. And if we really want change, it is not schools and colleges that can do something. It's a system. It's a political leadership. I'm yet to see in the world any country, except for Finland or Singapore, which has taken up taking the torch that let us redesign our education system. We are yet to have any leadership like that. We have the next slide. It's so easy to point fingers at education system. Everybody would say that the college is not doing well, the university is putting pressure on us. But my point in all this is, what are the learners doing? The system, it's so easy to criticize a system which does not have its own form, but has a function. But what are the learners doing in this? I have seen learners going on agitation for state division. I've seen learners going on agitation for the change of vice chancellor, for reservation, for stopping migrant workers, although it doesn't affect them personally. But I have not seen learners, I mean students, going on agitation for redesigning an education system. I have not seen learners going on a strike or an agitation for revamping the examination system. I'm yet to see any movement like that in this country or anywhere else. And this is where I want to pitch in my conversation with you all. What is my narrative? My narrative here is, as a principal of a school, have I remained in my seat as a designation as the head of the school? Or have I gone beyond the designation? Have I started being something else too? So that's where my narrative begins as a principal learner. My designation may be principal, but my function and my role and my responsibilities of a learner. So in the school, I'm the first learner. My nameplate says principal learner, okay? The system and paradigm shift can coexist. That's what my narrative talks about. So if you have a school, you have an exam. Like somebody was joking, democracy is not all about elections. School is not all about exam. School is about an organic narrative where you do something with the young people who come inside the realms of the school. So what did we do? We made the learners more important than the subject. We made trust more important than supervision. No invigilation during examination. Because if a learner is writing an exam, the exam is for the learner, not for the parents or the teachers. Okay? We made the excellence more important than examination. We made real world more important than textbooks, so we have no textbooks in the school at all. We made it transdisciplinary, because we are also used to being islands of math, islands of science, islands of social, English, and subjects like that, that we don't see connection between them. So we made it all transdisciplinary curriculum. And then, from silos to ecosystems, we didn't want students to remain in islands. It has to be a huge ecosystem where they connect to many more elements of life than just a micro thing called a subject. From a linear narrative to an organic narrative, and when I say that, I mean to say going from grade 9 to 10 to 11 to 12 to college, it's a linear narrative. An organic narrative is where, from 1 year to the next year, how much more empowered have you become? From pushing to inquiring, pushing the students to study, to creating a learning environment where they inquire on their own. They discover on their own what they have to learn. From future to present, typically the rhetoric anywhere is, if you study well today, tomorrow you will be something. Why should you be something tomorrow? Why can't you be something today? What's wrong with today? Is it something that you can't do anything today if you don't do something today? So the importance of today is more significant than by you studying doing something tomorrow. So we made the present more important. From dependence to independence, another trait of an Indian family system where children are made very dependent. Everything is so dependent, including your eating. Okay? We made the children feel independent. And then the last one is teacher-centric to student-centric. Now, what do I mean by this? Typically, teachers are the sages on the stages, right? All the pearls of wisdom come from teachers only. That is the kind of scenario we have in educational context. We changed that. Why can't the students teach each other? Why can't peer learning happen? So that's how we worked on the peer learning. So student-centric classrooms have become more vibrant and robust. So in all this, what do I want to talk about? I want to say my guru, Dr. Stephen Covey, while promoting the 7 habits, he talked about be proactive. What is being proactive? Between stimulus and the response, you have a choice to respond the way you want to respond. The system can restrain us. A CBSE or a state board or an ICSE or any kind of system in the country can restrain us. But if you choose the response you want to, you will find a way to make that system also cohabit with a paradigm shift. And that's what exactly we did in our school. We created a learning culture, a learning community, and we created an entire range of experiences around this word called learning. And if you notice, I use this word learner and learning extensively, because for me, this experience called learning is very sacrosanct. This person called learner, who is beyond all barriers like age, race, religion, region, come what may. There are no barriers to a person called learner. And there is something so energetic about a person who's the learner, you can feel the aura around him or her, okay? So we created these learning cultures and learning communities. There's something so sacrosanct about this entire experience that I really want to highlight upon this word called learning. Now, what is the role of a learner in a system which is almost like a dinosaur across the world, the education system? What are the learners doing in all this? If they're not choosing their responses, are they choosing to feel victimized? Are the learners feeling that just because the system is so restraining, I can't do anything? Are the learners taking refuge in this and not exploiting their own potential? And that's where I just want to ask all the learners, what are the learners doing? Are they really looking at their own potential? Because I always had this question. I've seen young people of different ages who'll get a smart gadget, who'll get a Harry Potter book, or even Twilight series. They explore it within no time, operate it within no time, demonstrate it within no time. But in this class, a teacher has to teach them something. In the class, a teacher has to explain a language, a theory, or a principle, because what is taught in the classroom is supposed to be taught by a teacher, but everything else the learner can explore on his or her own. I found it very baffling. Now, why do I want to bring this question of what are the learners doing? Because never in the history of learning till now did we ever have such a wonderful climate for learning. In the last century, so many centuries, we have always had the Gurukul system where teaching and learning happened within the realms of a formal system. But now, everything is thrown open. What are the learners and how are they exploiting this entire thing? If you have noticed, there is the technology which brought the, can we have the next slide? Yeah. The technology which brought the revolution. Learning, content, courses have been thrown open completely, free. No time barrier, no age barrier, no merit barrier. One doesn't have to write an examination also. One doesn't have to go to a university. One doesn't have to complete a competitive exam to do the course. You have it all from the Yale University to Stanford to MIT to Harvard. Everybody hosting their courses online, free of cost. And then you have the professors giving lectures. So what are the learners doing in this? How are they perceiving this entire explosion of online content, and how are they responding to that? Interviews, tests, and demonstrations are not the only avenues for learners to prove their mettle. You can prove your mettle by posting your video on YouTube that you have learned this. Because in MIT courses, if you see, you can learn the dynamics of sound from the Bose himself. If you see some courses like atomic energy, you see nuclear physics, emotional intelligence, social intelligence, simple topics to rocket science, everything is available online. So how are the learners looking at this scenario now? The learning landscape has completely changed. It has become from a privileged learning experience to an open learning experience, where you can just walk into and find your own path, direct your own self. One doesn't have to really feel constrained that I can't possibly get into that privileged university out there. Well, with this open source courses, it should be a utopia. Everybody should be scientists by now, mathematicians by now. Everybody should be psychologists by now. So is that happening? What are we seeing in the society right now? One problem that I perceive in all this is the society that is not coming out of the syndrome of rationed society. We believe that everything is still of scarcity. We are not looking at the abundance that's available. Again, Sir Ken Robinson, an eminent educationist whose pearls of wisdom are taken like gospels of truth by many people like us, like me. He said human intelligence is richer and more dynamic than we have been led to believe by formal academic education. We are so tuned to think that unless we go to a classroom, a college, a university, education doesn't happen. But our intelligence, human intelligence, is not being exploited by not coming out of these barriers. To summit one's own Everest, the learner has to take the first step. To summit one's own Everest. Now, Everest is 28,000 feet something. But you can set your Everest at 12,000, 13,000, like mine till now has been 14,000. And I think one day I will go up to 28,000. I'm not sure, but I have the aspiration. So right now my Everest has been set at 14,000. So how do learners set their own Everest? How did they plan their trek to summit the Everest? Is my provocation to the learners here. So do we hear with this kind of open source courses, with this kind of online content available, do we hear spectacular narratives? Or do we hear victim voices? And when I say victim voices, I find it very interesting. Okay? I find it very interesting that we need to understand the background of the learners to see whether they are able to summit their Everest or not. And at this point, I want to bring in Malcolm Gladwell's book, Outliers. One very astounding book. He's done extensive research on what makes a person successful. And in this book, he talked about birthday, birthplace, family, social construct. All these make a difference for a learner's success. Okay? So having introduced this at this point of time, I want to look at the background of the learners in the Indian context. Now look at the background of the students in Indian context. We have a cultural fabric, we have a societal structure, a family system, social constructs, hierarchical structure, binaries, and mindsets. I'll elaborate on each one of them. Now our cultural fabric is such that we believe that unless we go into a formal learning environment, unless we are monitored by adults, learning does not happen. Our societal structure is such that if you are not doing what everybody else is doing, then you are not a person at all. Family system. In a family system, everybody owns learning except the learner. The mother, the father, the grandparents, the neighbors, the relatives, everybody owns learning except the learner. Okay? And everybody controls the learning except the learner. Everybody makes decisions for the learner except the learner. Now look at the social constructs, that if you are not doing this course or that course, you are not going to go there or there, and you're going to go there. The social construct is such that it weighs very heavily on the learners. And then hierarchical structure. In our Asian system and again in the Indian system, we believe that only adults know everything. Children or teenagers, their opinions don't count. So adults have to be control freaks. There has to be a lot of conditional parenting to such an extent that adults make children believe that I know what is good for you. You don't know what is good for you. I know what is good for you. And the children start believing that I don't know what is good for me. My parent has to tell me whether I should eat this curry or that salad or this fruit. I have even tried when we started introducing student-centric methodology. These students have already understood the ratios of trigonometry by creating an engagement. But then at the end of it, the students ask, ma'am, when will you teach? Because they're so used to didactic approach that they don't even realize that there is a learning potential within them. So conditioning is so very harsh in our Indian system. It's not just Indian system, it's all over there in Asia. Because in the Western countries, historically speaking, creativity and leadership are encouraged. In Eastern societies, following is encouraged. So that's the reason we have these limitations on the learning behaviors. and now the binary. You are either in this profession or in that profession, or you are nowhere at all. Okay? These kind of limitations limit the learners today and does not make them recognize their own potential. A learner who's born in a digital age like you, if you can maneuver through a complicated electronic gadget, you mean to say you can't maneuver through a mathematical principle or a scientific principle? It's only because one believes that I need to be taught by an adult. I had very interesting experiences in understanding learners. I used to teach in the Northeast. I have seen a very interesting learning behavior in the students of the Northeast. For them, going to church, understanding a religion which they migrated to, in alignment with their native culture, housekeeping, washing, cleaning, cooking, whether boys or girls. Two, having friendships and relationships, everything is a part of their learning, not just that subject in the classroom. So they had an organic narrative, not just a narrow linear narrative of, I've done math and I've done science now, so I've reached somewhere. So their narrative was so cheerful. I have this experience working with underprivileged farm laborers' children in rural areas. The amount of science and math they come to class is mind-boggling. A child of 8 years already knows natural math, mass, volume. How much can a tractor, how many gunny bags of rice can a tractor take? Okay? Which part of the soil can I grow this, and which part of the soil is dry? And they also know the seasons, mass, volume, percentage, because they go along with their parents and sell the produce. So they know mathematical concepts even before they come to school. So for them, learning is all about a natural education, formalizing it. Another experience in a different zone. I work with children whose mothers are rescued from flesh trade or victims of human trafficking. Now, these children come to school because school is the only safe place where they don't have to see the harsh reality of their life. And what do? In the school? They dive into the learning, because they just want to forget what kind of life they have when they go out of the school. For them, learning is like a refugee camp. Okay? Now, coming to the international scenario, because we are an international school, so we also deal with international students. So I deal with students who are first culture, second culture, third culture kids, born in one country, brought up in another, working in a different country. Now, what kind of challenges do these students have? Just like we have in India, that if you are from one region, your accent is different, you're from another region, your complexion is different, they also have all those challenges. You're from a different race, different religion, but their learning narrative comes with assimilation, acceptance, ultimate resilience, and that's how they become more people than students. Now, coming to the background of relatively protected students, children who are protected, pampered to some extent, okay, how do they behave? They behave in a very different way because they're already taken care of. They're so well taken care of that they don't have to eat. Their mother or grandmother will feed them. They don't have to choose. Their family will choose for them. Everything is done by their family. Now, for them, their learning narrative is so narrow, such a silo, that they really don't know what choices they are making. They don't own the learnership. They don't own the learning that they do. So their experiences are pretty narrow. Now, with all this, what do I want to say? What do I want to prove here? Let me bring... In Malcolm Gladwell's book, he also talked about 10,000 hours of practice, okay? Paddy growing countries, everybody is used to waking up before 4 o'clock because when the sun rises and you have to work in the fields, your backs will burn. With that kind of culture, even the children are used to waking up early morning and practicing. So he gives a big narrative about, if you practice anything for 10,000 hours, you're an expert. And he gives a case study of Beatles in it. So 10,000 hours, culture, opportunities will lead to success. Now, what will lead to success to these people, whether in the Northeast or from the underprivileged background or the hostile background or the pampered and the protected background? Different kinds of students, wonderful experiences that I have. But I just feel that having understood what kind of fine education system Finland has, the only secret is all about they give space to the learners. They first condition the learners to believe that, know yourself. It's very important to know yourself, very important to know who you are, okay? And that's where I want to bring in, just like Malcolm Gladwell suggested, a pyramid of suggestions, I also have my own suggestions. It's very important for all the learners to know who you are. What are your personal standards? Your personal physical standards? What do you believe about mental fitness, physical fitness? What do you believe about who you are as a human being? What is your value system? Know who you are. Where you are in place and time. If you are today in Coimbatore, what is Coimbatore about? Where are you going to be henceforth? And how is the world going to change? And what are you going to do in this big world with 7 billion people right now and 7 billion plus in future? What is your role? And next thing is, how do you express yourself? Are people wanting to listen to you? Do you know how to talk in a way where people want to listen? Do you have intentions to communicate? And what are your intentions? And the next thing is, how do you organize yourself? How do you organize your thoughts, your work, your room, your books, and everything that is all about you? How do you come out as a learner? How do people perceive you? Very important for schools and colleges to train learners into these things first. And then we have how the world works. Now, if you're learning about technology, technology is an offshoot of understanding of science. If we are able to play tennis, it's because we understood there's something called motion, pressure, air, okay? Only because we have ideas of science, we are able to apply it in technology. So how the world works around us is the most important understanding a learner has to develop. And lastly, with whom do we share the planet? With all the living things? So what do we do to this environment? Like the gentleman in the Bhutanese talk had talked about, they are carbon neutral, but the people, what they are doing in other countries is causing their icebergs to melt. So it is very important for us to know, what am I doing today which is going to impact the planet? And with whom am I sharing the planet with? Keeping all these big conceptual understandings in mind, if the learner knows and happy with himself, happy with people around, happy with the society and the environment, I guess then he has a vibrant, wonderful narrative to talk about. And that's why I keep saying that. Create a spectacular narrative on your own profile as a learner. Summit your own Everest, determine your own altitude. Nobody, no system need to do it. It's in your hands and you would know how to do it because you be the change you wish to see in the world. That's what Mahatma Gandhi said. If you want to change, don't criticize anything. Find a way, ingenious ways to make sure that education works for you and what kind of education you want. You be the change you wish to see in the world. And I'm so thankful that I have the opportunity to talk to you all today. Okay? Thank you.